Hello, welcome to the Health In Show, an affiliate program of Homeopathy World Community. You've come to the right place to tune in and participate with your comments and questions. Love is the greatest healer of all. But sometimes, in order to change our emotions, we must take action in other spheres of our lives. We speak with experts in alternative and complementary health fields and hope you will benefit in some small or great way. Remember, you are wherever your thoughts are. Make sure your thoughts are where you want to be.
Good morning, everyone, or good afternoon, or good evening, wherever you are. My name is Marilyn Shannon, and this is the Health In Show. And once again, we dedicate our show to Debbie, and her waves of awareness will continue forever and ever and ever. Today, we have a very exciting show in store for you. But before we go on with the show, I just want to remind each and every one of you to please feel free to connect with us in our chat. You can just put your nickname, name, whatever you like, and you can comment, ask questions in there. I see several people in there already. And then you can also call us into the studio when you have a question at 919-518-9773. This is an open invitation anytime during the show to please contact us. And you can come in on Skype at computers, that's plural, then the number 2K voice. You will come in on Skype voice anytime you like as well from anywhere in the world. And we know people are watching us, listening to us from all over. So we're excited to get on with our show. So let me introduce Kavitha to you. She's going to be moderating along with me and Deepak. And we have an exciting show. So here we go. Hi, Kavitha.
Hi, Madeline.
How are you?
Hello, everyone. This is Kavitha Kuchner, homeopath from Michigan. First, I wanted to thank Amnon for helping us with doing the Health In Shows. And all our Health In Shows are dedicated to Debbie and for educational purpose and for public awareness. They are not intended to provide any self-treatment for any serious conditions. And before we get on to the today's topic, I would like to remind our audience to sign the Homeopathy FDA Citizens Petition issued by Americans for Homeopathy Choice to protect homeopathic medicine USA. It is a volunteering organization founded by Paula Braun. So far, we had over 9,000 comments and needs to reach 10K. And today is the last date to sign the petition. And a link will be provided in the chat. And in November, we had a wonderful show with Dr. Nancy about these FDA changes, and a recording will be available on the Nissan Communications if you have missed it. And we have the sign, the homeopathypetition.com is their website. And today's topic is cancer management and homeopathy. I know every year, nearly 500,000 of Americans, they die from cancer, and currently cancer is widespread and people are trying to prevent complications or protect them from cancer using the alternatives, homeopathy and other therapies. And we have very good homeopathic remedies helping the different types of cancer patients. Today we have very, very special guest, Manfred Mueller. He is a well-known homeopath, and no need to introduce him because he's known. But for those who do not know Manfred, he's a German-born US homeopath. He has been in the field of homeopathy since 1979. In 1989, Mueller founded the Homeopathic College, which taught a four-year undergraduate program from 1989 to 1999. In his work, he integrates current scientific insight into the Hahnemannian methodology without sacrificing the principles of classical homeopathy. And beginning in 1990, he developed reverse chronological tautopathy, a comprehensive approach to homeopathic treatment for adverse effects of infections, vaccinations, x-rays, and other medical procedures. In 2007, the college reopened, teaching the advanced homeopathic topics such as how to treat multiple disorders at once and complex conditions, and to remove the predisposition to cancer, identify, remove, and antidote the obstacles to cure. His unique method of approaching a case known as the Mueller method. He has taught a module on homeopathy at University of School of Medicine in North Carolina since 1995. Mueller was the president of North American Society of Homeopaths from 2005 to 2014 and board member in 2015. In 2017, he published the book Homeopathic Cancer Drugs, Oncology, Metal Medica, the first clinical Metal Medica ever had over 600 remedies. And it is available on his website and Amazon. He has published extensive several articles, research, reviews, resolution to seizures, and multiple sclerosis, and legislative directives for alternative practitioners, and so much more. He's married and father of 7 children. If you wanted to learn more about him, you can reach his website, thehomeopathiccollege.org, and you can also reach him at 619-741-5795 or info@homeopathiccollege.org. Let us welcome Manfred Mueller to our show.
Thank you, Kavita. Glad to be here.
Oh, wonderful. So Manfred, before we jump on to the homeopathic management and for the cancer, let us talk a little bit about the main causes of predisposition for the cancer.
Yes, well, in the classical homeopathy, the original analysis that Hahnemann conducted more than 200 years ago was that cancer was essentially a soric disorder that arose out of the chronic soric miasm. Most homeopaths are familiar with it. It is also been translated into the mother of all miasms and or interpreted as such by Hahnemann. Hahnemann thought cancer was an external expression of that miasm. In his time, cancers were mostly external. That means they were skin cancers, like he treated the case of cancer of the eye of the famous Field Marshal Radetzky in Austria. And he also saw that sometimes breast cancer was an expression of this internal malady he called SORA. Since Hahnemann, homeopaths have added to that the psychotic miasm, which is the miasm that causes proliferations and tumors everywhere, including warts, molds, and other proliferations. And a combination of SORA and gonorrhea could potentially have been a chronic disorder that preceded cancer as a predisposition. Since that was added, Hahnemann also thought that the syphilis played a role in cancer with its tendency to have destructive effects in cancer. We often see ulceration as one of the symptoms. And then finally, tuberculosis, which was perceived to be a combination of a soric miasm and a syphilitic miasm, it had some of the additional characteristics such as wasting away. In cancer, we have the cachexia. And in homeopathy, we see descriptions that are of the symptoms of the disorder. And those are also matched with descriptions that our medicines produce when they're tested on healthy people. So part of the cancer diathesis is presumably a predisposition to contagious disorders that took place long ago that has somehow affected our DNA. But since Hahnemann and since the so-called classical era of homeopathy, we have far more to talk about when it comes to cancer. And today, cancer is no longer a soric disease. Today, cancer is a toxic disease. And that is a very big step to understand that. for many homeopaths because they hardly ever deal with that problem. Hahnemann identified it in his Organon. Early on, he talked in Organon 74 and 75, he talked about the iatrogenic disorders. That included also disorders like mercury. In his day, mercury was one of the most devastating medications that was used in high doses, and it poisoned people. And homeopaths spend the next 100 years trying to figure out how to counter those disorders. Hahnemann himself said they were incurable. However, we've learned a lot since Hahnemann, and we can apply our modern scientific insight into the disorders that come out of the iatrogenic misuse of drugs. We also have disorders today that are environmental in nature. I'm going to stop here and give you a chance to ask me more questions.
So, Manfred, overall, how is the statistics of the cancer and most common different types of cancers we are seeing in the United States?
Well, the United States is the cancer capital of the world. We have, as you said, 500,000 cancer deaths every year. Actually, for 2018, the projection was 600,000. It has been that high, but the medical establishment says we're making progress. We're reducing the amount of cancer. From research, however, it doesn't appear to be the treatment that causes a reduction in cancer, because we have two studies that tell us that it in the last 2 years, I think they were, from British hospitals, that they show that 50% approximately of cancer patients unfortunately die from chemotherapy. And that's something that we should keep in mind. Coming back to your question, we have an enormous number of breast cancers, prostate cancers, stomach cancers, and lung cancers in this country. These are probably some of the main ones. We also have lymphoma. We have skin cancers, vast number of skin cancers. We have really all kinds of cancers in the U.S. And what's even more disturbing is we have an increasing number of cancer in children. That is a totally new development. You don't find that much in the homeopathic literature prior to the 1950s. When we look at the cancer then, it was an old age disease. Today, it's unfortunately a childhood disease also.
That's Manfred. And Dr. Deepak, would you have any questions for Manfred?
Sir, I have a question. Can homeopathy remove the disposition of cancer from genetic to genetics?
Yes, it is a genetic predisposition. The most suitable, the most common remedy from a homeopathic point of view is the remedy carcinosinum, which is made from a cancer. It's actually made from a discharge from a breast cancer in the 19th century. And apparently, when they did the provings, that means when they gave this remedy in potency to a number of volunteers, they brought out some of the typical symptoms that we associated with, we could say, the cancer patient. The cancer patient is often a kind person, very sympathetic person. They love animals. They are often very much sympathetic in general, which often has the effect that they become victimized by others. And so you could say if someone appears to have a target on them, they are probably in need of the remedy carcinosin. We see this often in cancer patients, that they tend to be weak or sensitive in that way. We also see other more common characteristics, which I have explained thoroughly in my dissertations on the cancer diathesis. I also have a DVD that I gave a lecture to the Texas Homeopathic Medical Society in 2011. It's available on our website. It's a 6-hour DVD that you can watch about this topic alone.
Okay, thank you, sir. So do you think then that the carcinosin is removing the tendency to get the cancers from the next generation?
Good question. I'm sorry I didn't answer that. Yes, when you give this remedy for several years, daily, in daily doses, and we give it in Q potencies rather than in high centesimal potencies, which sometimes is too strong and too much for the patient. Q potencies are not as well known, but they were the last potentization methodology that Hahnemann had developed. He called them quinquagindamillesimal. That's where the Q comes from. In Britain, they were called LM potency because they thought LM was the Roman numeral for 50,000, which quinquagindamillesimal means 50,000. Actually means 900. So it's a misnomer. They also prepare it slightly different from the way Hahnemann had described it. But you can get Q potencies from many modern pharmacies, including Remedia in Austria, from Helios, and in the United States from Hahnemann Labs. There are also certain rules about the Q potencies that you need to know. And also, I have been able to, through direct observation, develop some of the rules because we don't have much experience from the homeopathic community as a whole in Q potencies. So the people who have used them, many German homeopaths like Dr. Georg von Keller, you would give them for 3 weeks and then you would raise the potency. We would start with the low potencies and then go up from there. I found that today many people are too sensitive to repeat the those once a day for more than 10 days. So we limit it to 10 days and then we change the potency and go up from there. We have tutorials on all of these topics. You can find them on our website, which is thehomeopathiccollege.org. And we can you can find the various tutorials under different subjects.
Fantastic to know, sir. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Thank you. So Manfred, can you just talk about how do we manage cancer with homeopathy?
Right. Well, I mean, cancer patients in the United States are not managed by homeopaths. They always have an oncologist. They come to you with a diagnosis. People don't self-diagnose cancer. Often the cancer is diagnosed accidentally. Because of some other disorder, they get diagnostic tests, and suddenly they are told they have cancer. If they're alternative minded, which is not common in the United States, although it is becoming more common, then they might contact a homeopath. Then, as a homeopath, what do we do? Well, first of all, it depends on the kind of tumor we're dealing with. Cancer is more than just a tumor, but the tumors are significant, and we need to understand that there are different tumors. Some tumors are aggressive. That means they can kill the patient in a very short period of time. And often you don't know for sure whether they're aggressive or not, because oncologists don't always know. If the patient has had a biopsy, where they are told that they have only very short time to live, first of all, that makes things a little easier because you then can often extend the life of these patients. It's not uncommon that people are told you have 6 months to live. There's nothing we can do for you, like in certain kinds of sarcomas that affect vital organs. There's nothing we can do. And then they come to homeopaths. Homeopaths are often a last resort in America. There are also many alternative methods, such as Chinese medicine, such as Ayurvedic medicine. There are many other many other alternative forms of treatment, including technological forms that includes radiation, like low-level radiation, radio waves that are used for cancer, ozonation, intravenous vitamin C, etc. So. With homeopathy, we often quickly improve the way the patients feel if they don't feel well. But that's not the most common issue in cancer. Mostly cancer patients don't have symptoms. That's one of the difficulties for homeopaths. When inexperienced homeopaths first address cancer, they will look for symptoms. And they may have some methods, such as constitutional methods. Excuse me. However, that approach doesn't lead anywhere because, you know, even if you have pigeonholed, which some people do, that person's constitution, often that remedy will do nothing for that tumor. And your patient dies in spite of the correct constitutional remedy. So that's something very important to keep in mind when managing homeopathic cancer patients. So what do we need to do? One of the most important thing is we need to have a comprehensive approach. That means we need to look at all of the factors. All of the factors includes the type of tumor, the prognosis for the type of cancer these people have, whether it has affected vital organs, of course, the whole history. Is it metastatic or is it stage four? Stage four is usually the most advanced form of cancer, and so on. The reason why I say we need to use homeopathy with cancer, and that should be used. It should be used in every single cancer case, except in America, 99% of Americans have no idea what homeopathy is. Only 1% of Americans would consider homeopathy as their treatment for cancer. We also do not advocate that people not use conventional medicine. In many cases, especially the more conservative approaches in conventional medicines, are necessary to shrink a tumor to save the life of the patient before we start homeopathic treatment. For more information on that, we have all tutorials about that. I've also collected a number of research papers mostly from Europe, where they use this widely. Homeopathy is widely used in Europe for cancer treatment, usually in conjunction with conventional treatment, although in many cases, patients opt out of the conventional treatment, in which case homeopathy does all the work.
So Manfred, sorry to interrupt.
No, Kavitha.
Many cases responding to homeopathy. That's what you're saying, right?
That's correct.
And so just a few couple of cases, just at a high level, how they came up and how homeopathy helped them. Just in a few words.
Kavitha, and when you're done with this one, I have a simple question I want to ask. So
okay. I don't know how much to tell you. There are many cases, but a typical case was, let me give you a prostate cancer case. This is a 70-year-old couple who had listened to a lecture in North Carolina I gave to a church group. I was invited to give a lecture about homeopathic cancer treatment. Anyway, after the lecture, this gentleman approached me. Turns out he had heart disease and had recently been diagnosed with prostate cancer. He already had open heart surgery, so there were complications in the history. I identified two homeopathic remedies. First of all, the constitution needed to be addressed to cancer, which was an inherited constitution. There were several cancer cases, including his mother and his grandmother on the maternal side, which often is an indication of a cancer diathesis also, by the way. 100% of cancer of offspring from mothers who have cancer have the cancer diathesis. Not so many, I would say, from if it's on the father's side. But in this case, the physician had diagnosed prostate cancer. They opted not to do a biopsy, which I supported because I feel like biopsies sometimes spread cancer. This has also been confirmed to me by several oncologists. They feel like sometimes biopsies spread cancer. In this case, it wasn't necessary to do a biopsy because the diagnosis was very clear-cut. We had an irregular-shaped tumor on the back of the prostate. It was hard. It was growing. And these are the characteristics of cancer. There is no other diagnosis. This was confirmed by x-rays. The tumor was approximately 1 centimeter in diameter, so it wasn't too large, and it was not causing serious discomfort for this gentleman, but his overall energy level had reduced. He was unable to play golf, which is something that he did, being retired, every day. I did select as a tumor-specific remedy the remedy conium. The conium was also justified for other reasons. We alternated in Q potencies conium and carcinosinum. And during the first 4 months, we observed no effect on the tumor itself. There was also some signs that his physical constitution resembled that of lycopodium. So I added lycopodium to the mix. And by the way, 4 months of a hard tumor that has been there probably for quite a while, was accidentally diagnosed, is not very long to wait in homeopathic treatment. Nevertheless, after about 6 months, we saw movement. The tumor appeared to recede according to a medical exam that was conducted with his oncologist. Again, he refused biopsy at this point. We also don't do x-rays at this point. In conventional cancer treatment, oncologists tend to bombard their patients with x-rays. We don't. The reason for this is that one single x-ray, according to the authorities, Dr. John W. Goffman, who used to be at Berkeley, was an expert. He's written several books about this. Feel free to read those books. He recommends against x-rays unless absolutely necessary, because he said one single x-ray can induce cancer. We don't want the cancer to grow more. So we gave one remedy in the morning, one remedy at night, one remedy at noon, and he also instituted a almost radical dietary and juicing program. This was probably perhaps the most dedicated couple I've ever seen, considering their age and the low energy he was at first. This was amazing. They actually sent me a picture of their operation. They had someone manufacture a press for themselves, and they used a standard masticating juicer to make juice that he could drink. He drank 16 8-ounce glasses of juice per day, in addition to his taking his homeopathic remedies. And that was pretty much all the treatment he used.
Interesting case, Manfred. Thank you. That's amazing. And Madeline, you have any questions?
Yes, I do. And I do have a question, but I also want to say that, you know, I'm listening to you, and I recall with Debbie, she did, you know, when she was first diagnosed, they just told her to go home and get her papers in order. That was it. That's what they told her the moment they gave her the diagnosis. But she lived.
And that reflects their experience.
And she lived for 4 years.
I know.
After that, with doing what everything that you're saying is what I remember Debbie doing, juicing, drinking special water, doing her homeopathy. Everything that you're saying is exactly what she did. And she got to live 4 more years with her family and her, in her life. So there is a great deal to what you're saying. My question is, as a non-homeopath, is there anything we can do in using homeopathy, even when, I mean, we're not diagnosed with cancer, but who knows what's going on inside of us? Is there anything we can do just ongoing?
To prevent cancer?
Yes, as far as homeopathy is concerned.
Yes. I recommend, and I'm not a doctor, so I don't, my recommendation doesn't count as a medical recommendation, that everyone take the remedy carcinosin now. That's after observing the situation for more than 30 years. And trying different things, only in the Q potencies. However, we have noticed some complications in some people, especially those who have previously been suppressed for other disorders with medication. People who have a history of medication, this becomes an obstacle to cure and actually causes a carcinosin to aggravate the patient. And so this is not indicated for everyone, really. So I shouldn't use this as a panacea, but it really is possible for virtually 99% of patients to take carcinosin without any adverse reaction. Those few adverse reactions do, however, happen. If you know how to do it, if you're a homeopath and avoid those, we avoid them 100% in our treatment. But there's other things. You can also focus on a diet that reduces animal proteins and animal fats, but wide variety, good nutrition, all organic food. There are many things we can do. The most important factor today that most people don't want to hear about is ditch your cell phone.
Do what?
Ditch your mobile phone. Get rid of it. Don't use one. I have not used one in 15 years now myself. Also, disconnect Wi-Fi in your property. In America, we have the privilege often to have a house. Elsewhere in the world, people live in tiny little places, but with other people next door, so they receive Wi-Fi from many different places. But then on the other hand, we often need to make changes in our life. This is one of the things I would say. Yeah, get rid of the Wi-Fi. Also, vaccines trigger cancer. The flu vaccine, for example, flu shot. Don't get the flu shot. Those are terrible things. There are many better ways to avoid the flu, to prevent the flu, even in elderly patients. Some of our patients are in their 90s. They don't take medication. They don't take vaccines, and they're doing wonderfully. One of my clients recently went to the hospital for a medical checkup, and they said he was the only patient at his age, in his 90s, I think he's 91, that they have ever seen who was not on medication. He was on homeopathy.
And Manfred, in addition, adding to it, we have dietary things. And Debbie used to take these mushrooms because mushrooms are very good. The turkey tail mushroom and basil extract mushroom. So she told me, Kavita, you can take even just like immune purpose. So just if you have anything more, like even alkaline foods can prevent. Oh, yeah.
Absolutely. Alkaline foods can, but we have tested carcinosinum, and it reduces the body's acidity to the point where the urine becomes alkaline. When you one patient conducted a test on herself because she took carcinosinum daily, and after 2 weeks, she was alkaline. Then when she stopped taking it, she was back to acidic. And then again, she took carcinosin and went back to alkaline. So that is what carcinosin does. It actually changes the body. It also affects the DNA. It will get rid of, eventually, that tendency towards developing proliferations, wasting away. The whole thing is affected by the DNA, the so-called oncogene. Evidently, carcinosin can change that. There is even studies that confirm that. Please review my, I wrote three reviews, 2007, 2012, and 2018, in 18 was published. They were published reviews. You have no idea how many studies there are proving that homeopathy recedes tumors in vitro and in vivo. We even have clinical studies confirming this. Please review my three papers. They're available for free on our website, thehomeopathiccollege.org. We also have a blog on our website, and feel free to
catch up on that.
You're welcome.
Just before, and I just received a note from Kathy. She just said, like, we have received 13,715 comments, FDA comments. Thank you to all who have made it. And Deepak, go ahead.
Yes, sir. What are your thoughts for the people who do not know about the homeopathy? So what you say about homeopathy, and then why common people use the homeopathy in cancer? What the specialty of homeopathy?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear the last question.
Sir, the common person in the world, those who don't know about homeopathy, then they are asking why we are using homeopathy for the cancers. Then what is your thoughts?
The good question. The main reason why homeopathy should be used first is the fact that it's completely safe. Homeopathy doesn't kill anybody. Zero people have been killed by homeopathy. They were trying to in Australia, they're trying to concoct one or two deaths, which they were concocted. As I said, they were not real due to homeopathy, but they pretend they were. So I feel like homeopathy ought to be used by everybody first, because it can be effective. And if you do it judiciously and don't wait too long in some cases, and if you don't interfere, it has clearly had a lot of benefits. It also encapsulates the tumors to where it can be surgically removed later easily if necessary. It also reduces the mortality and increases the survival of patients in almost every single case.
Wonderful, sir. Thank you. And one more query, sir. Sir, the homeopathy, the medicine, instead of the using carcinosin, what I suggested to everyone and every people that you should consult with your homeopath near to you. Or you just consult with the you or the like who are registered homeopaths. So carcinosin is really a deep acting medicine.
And even by a professional homeopath.
Yes. And carcinosin, we are using Q potency since 5 years. So we are very well known to Q potency in India. There is a lot of Q potencies available in all medicines. And everything is available. But instead of that, that you are using self-carcinosin, instead of that, you use the consult with the homeopath near to you, or consult with you or your website or SWC or anywhere, any from any platform.
Yes,
they cannot
thank
take
you.
Self-administration. That's correct, Dr. Deepak. And Manfred, right. How about you just talk a few words about your new book? It's oncology book, Mater Medica.
Yes, we don't have much time today, but it's a very extensive Mater Medica, very much detailed. It has sections that identify the medicines. It identifies the pathologies that have been used for historically. Then finally, it gives indications for those. It gives a full symptomatology. It gives differential diagnosis options, interaction warnings or notes. It has clinical notations from primarily from people who have used it for cancer. It has a posology section, which means what potency and dose. And if you have studied homeopathy thoroughly, you understand there's a difference between the potency and the dose. If you don't know this, you need to contact our college and listen to the tutorial on posology. We also have a section that was on the pharmacology of each substance, which gives more additional information, such as whether it's a carcinogenic substance originally or whether it is not and in under what circumstances. There are many details there. We have a section that lists trials, scientific trials that includes homeopathic especially trials. And then finally, a case documentation from the literature. I've used hundreds of journals and books for the purpose of that. So this whole thing has about 2,000 plus pages. Unfortunately, it's no longer available. It is out of print. So we're working on getting a second edition out. The first edition was in two volumes. The second edition will be in one volume. Feel free to email me and let me know that you're interested, because it helps us determine how many books we need to print.
Thank you, Manfred. Great. And for those who are interested to learn more about it and want to reach Manfred, they can reach his website, thehomeopathiccollege.org. And Dr. Deepak, you have any more questions? I think we have 5 to 10 minutes, right, Marilyn?
No, more like 5.
5 minutes. Yes. So Deepak, do you have any questions?
Sir, it's a wonderful to know about your miasmatic concept of the cancer. So what do you feel, that you will solve out the syphilitic phase easily, or the psychotic phase, or the psoric phase? Did you see any case who is converted from syphilis to psoric?
No, not that much in the United States. This is a very minor issue nowadays. In America, cancer is clearly a radiation-induced or toxic disease. There's no question about it when you take the history, which we do very carefully, of every single patient. And we also take a family history to determine what sort of inherited baggage there is. Most people have no clue whether there was ever syphilis or gonorrhea or anything else in their family history. They do not know. And it really doesn't seem to matter. So we focus in America, we focus on the toxins, which is why we remove the known causes. We also treat for the effects. That means you look at the reverse chronological tautopathy. For example, I have a case of right parotid cancer. I found in actually two, I found in both cases exposure to Agent Orange, these are both Vietnam War veterans, Agent Orange was used. Well, if you look up Agent Orange, you'll find it can cause parotid cancer. So there are many clear-cut indications in our research, and we do constant scientific research on the causes of cancer, and we try to counter those. We're way beyond what has ever been done traditionally in classical homeopathy. So whatever we do, I teach, because it works.
That's so nice. And final words, Manfred, your final words for the show you wanted to convey to the audience.
I'm sorry, could you repeat?
Your final words for this show you wanted to convey to the audience with respect to our topic.
Yes, for this topic, it's important to realize that cancer is an extremely multiple cause disorder. Multiple cause in the sense that there are many, many, many different toxic causes. There is worldwide radiation. All of these needs to be removed. So you need to take precautions. If you want to prevent cancer, that's also the latest question. Use things that have been proven to work to reduce the toxic exposures from radioactive fallout, which is now being blown around the whole globe from Fukushima after a disaster at a nuclear power plant there. You can use chlorella. Chlorella in the correct form is able to remove many of those toxic residues in your body. And there's charcoal. There are many cultured foods that you can use that are very able to bind to the toxic substances in your body, like miso, like sauerkraut, like many dairy products. In the 19th century, homeopaths knew that gluten in powdered form in France was recommended in the homeopathic Materia Medica, binds to mercury and helps remove mercury. There are many, many things you can do yourself, and then there are many things that we can do as expert in detoxification and removing causes. You're welcome.
Antioxidants and a lot more. Thank you, Manfred. And one thing what I would say, since Marilyn has brought the topic, yes, Debbie, from 2014 until 2018, she managed it. And all this was because of her positive inspiration, love, caring, hope, everything. She always says the spread love. The butterfly, yes. She interested me. So as Manfred said, cancer, we can deal with homeopathy, physical, mental, emotional, everything. And with your support, the one thing which me and Debbie did was a prayer to God that made such a positive vibration that it linked it, a hope to live. And in the form of Friends Forever series, that's amazing. And it worked ahead. Until her last breath, she lived a full life and she encouraged everyone. And she's a role model for us. And there are so many people, Dr. Regina, Dr. Watson, and so many, if I forget the name, they all saw the YouTube videos or the anything. So the final thing which I would say to a cancer patient, client, or any person, provide your love, care, and make them feel good. Thank you all. And Deepak, Dr.
Thank
Deepak.
You. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Your words.
It's really fantastic to know about cancers by sir. So really good to sir. And we will see you soon again. Thank you,
thank
sir.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you once again, Manfred. It was very nice. I know in short time, we cannot cover in depth, but it was a wonderful thing. And people can reach, if they have any questions, they can reach Marilyn Shannon. They can reach our website, Homeopathy World Community. They can reach Dr. Deepak. They can reach me. And Amnon, thank you so much, as always. Thank you all the audience.
And let me just also just reiterate that we are in the process of building a new Homeopathy World Community website. We hope to be doing these shows on a monthly basis when possible. And we just want to be here as a resource and to support and answer questions. So please reach out to us if you have any questions or want to know anything at all. We've got tremendous support. So thank you all so much.
Thank you,
Manfred. Thank you so much. I'm going to want to invite you on my other show. I think this is a great topic.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
Okay, we'll see you soon.
You are tuned to the Nissan Communications Network. If you tuned in too late, you can always watch each program in its entirety or download an MP3 audio file of it in the archives section at nissancommunications.com. Don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel, follow us on Twitter, and like us on Facebook. Sponsored by Telestream's Wirecast Software, StreamingGear.com, Carolina Apparel, and DeltaForce.net.